So many thanks for this kind introduction and for the invitation to talk at these omics days about exploiting data for health. First, a short introduction about in the institute I work with. It's Institut Curie. It's a comprehensive cancer center, meaning that we have both hospitals, three hospitals, and research centers, three sites, and we are devoted to the fight against cancer. And we have, I mean, fundamental research, but also translational and clinical research. And it's really a nice place to be if you want to solve questions related to oncology, in particular with high performance statistics and computing. I also hold a chair in a new institute, the Prairie Paris Institute for Artificial Intelligence Research. This institute is devoted to methodological research in AI, so that's hardcore mathematics, but also to interdisciplinary research in different applied sciences, in particular biology and medicine, and that's why I'm in this institute. And there are many different partners, both academic and industrial, and a few pharma like Pfizer and Janssen, which are interested in artificial intelligence in health. We are four different persons in the department to all chairs in this institute. We recruit postdocs and PhD students, so don't hesitate to apply if you want. So my specialty is cancer. So I'd like to maybe to start by giving a glimpse about the modification of the landscape of cancer treatment and research recently. I guess you all know now that there are many data that can be collected and which have influence on cancer development or cancer treatment, and that's of all these omics data, but also imaging, of course, and many other types of data that you can collect through, for example, your connected objects like your smartphone or your smartwatch and so on. And so the question is how to make use of all of these data. And there are many different projects that have been launched worldwide to enable the usage of these high throughput data to individualize the treatment of patients, because in particular in cancer, I mean, there are no two identical cancers. All patients have different cancers. So this data is really an opportunity to individualize the treatment. And among them, I mean, maybe the most successful in Europe so far is 100K Genome England, which completed the sequencing of almost 100,000 samples. With quite, I mean, significant results, because half of them as to cancer has led to a potential therapy or clinical trial for the patient. Another very, impressive work was the Danish National Patient Register. You know, there are 6 million Danish, and they've built a huge register which collects all of the data, medical data from Danish people. And it's been used for many purposes of research, and for example, finding comorbidities and anticipating the treatment of potential disease developments. In France, we also have this type of effort with France Medicine Genomics. This effort was launched 3 years ago now, and with the idea of sequencing the genome and the transcriptome also of patients with rare disease and with cancer. So it has started now, and the Sequoia platform, one of the two platforms who's doing sequencing, where Curie is part of, has already completed 3,400 genomes. So, but it's moving ahead and forward. And last but not least in my list, the Health Data Hub, which was created almost 1 year ago, I would say, with the aim of collecting all health data which are reimbursed by Social Security in France, so providing both medical doctors and researchers with a wealth of information to improve the treatment and the care of patients. Okay, so to me it seemed that this situation led us to a new feature for medicine, which is recapitulated on this slide. The idea is that, can you see my pointer, by the way? Well, the idea is that
Yeah, that's okay.
Thank you. A new patient coming to the doctor would discuss with him, and having, at their disposal, all the data records regarding these patients, both the medical records, but the lifestyle records and so on, and being able to simulate a digital twin of the patient and figure out which treatment would be optimal if she suffers some conditions, which adverse effects she might expect, and also how to adapt her lifestyle to avoid becoming sick. And to me, this picture is not science fiction. It's already starting to happen. And the question is how to make it happen the best possible from an ethical point of view by preserving the patient's right and improving the dialogue with the physician rather than with the machine. But it will happen. That's my point. And altogether, throughout the ages, there have been several paradigms of medicine. And these data, era, inaugurate a new paradigm. First, there was this symptom-based medicine. We all have in mind, the mocking of Molière with his doctor who say that, okay, you suffer from the stomach because you have a pain, so something which is very descriptive. Then the cause-based medicine, and maybe the most prominent figure is Pasteur with the discovery of microbes and infectious diseases. And then the mechanism-based medicine, we can give as examples the understanding of different molecular pathways which control cell proliferation and the ability to design drugs that will interfere with, for example, the kinase active sites and prevent proliferation. And now we have this data-driven medicine. And there I would like to give a warning because by going to the data-driven medicine, of course, we have the opportunity to do a lot of improvement in pragmatically taking patient into the care journey. But on the other hand, it means that we, in many cases, using artificial intelligence, we lose a bit in terms of understanding what's going on explaining why we take a medical decision. And in our research in Curie, what we try to do is to marry the best of artificial intelligence and mechanism-based approaches, both in the biology research and also in the clinical research. Okay, so I finished my introduction. I will tell you three brief stories, one on medulloblastoma, multi-omics analysis, one on a methodology for learning trajectories, for example, in single cell transcriptome, and the last one on dynamic disease phenotyping. So medulloblastoma. First, as a starter, I will say that pediatric cancer are orphan diseases. Maybe you know that. It means that they are not taken care of enough. And there are several reasons for that. First, there is satisfactory, a low incidence of this disease. So the market is small and it's not interesting for pharma companies to develop drugs. And there is also lack of funding for the early stage of research. And then, the applied research suffer from this lack of funding at the early stage as well. There are also, much less therapeutic options in terms of molecular targets than other cancers. If you take, for example, this slide, you see different types of cancer and the frequency of mutation of this cancer. You can see that melanoma and lung are very mutated. But if you look, for example, at medulloblastoma I just mentioned before, it's something like two orders of magnitude less mutated than the melanoma and lung. It means that when you look for a target, well, you have much less options. So that's also difficulty for developing drugs. Of course, toxic side effect is also a major problem in children. And they are undergoing development, so it's more than for adults. And there is a high cost of conducting trials and treatment. But in Curie, we are devoted to develop the research on pediatric cancers. So the story I will tell you is about one of them, medulloblastoma. First, a few facts. It's not very common. It's 15 cases per year in France, but still is the most common malignant solid brain tumor of childhood. It's located in the cerebellum here on this image. And it affects mainly young children. The bad thing about it is that one third of patients are not curable. And the other two thirds are, for most of them, severely damaged by the treatment. It can be speech impairment, cognition problems, behavioral problems, and they're prone to develop a second cancer. So what's the picture of medulloblastoma today? Well, now for 10 years now, we have a classification of the disease in four different subtypes. They will come in the rest of the presentation as blue, red, yellow, and green. And this classification is now based on the molecular profiling of the tumors, both RNA and methylation, DNA methylation. These four groups are quite different. The first one is characterized as mutation in the Wnt pathway, while the second one is characterized by mutation in FHH. The third one and the fourth one don't have any driver mutation, though there are many MYC mutations in the third one. So that's why they have not, they have no name except three and four. They also have heterogeneous clinical and biological portraits. Here we show a PCA of the transcriptome of these different types of tumors. You can see that the first one and the second one are very different from the others, and groups three and four are a bit overlapping, which kind of the problem. All the more when you know the fate of the patient affected by this disease, depending on the group. You can see on this slide that the survival of the patients is very different from group FHH, which is very bad. Survival decreases sharply, whereas group four has a much, and group have a much better survival rate. And you can also see that group three and four, yellow and green, have quite different survival rates. We are 10% of deaths, 25% of deaths. Those are overlapping from the biological picture we have here. So that's a difficulty that we have. And I mean, distinguishing group three and group four is really a key problem in medulloblastoma because aggressive treatment are required in group three, whereas in group four, milder treatments might be acceptable. And better for the patient. So together with Olivier Hérault, who's the PI behind the project from as well from Institut Curie, we decided to conduct a study on medulloblastoma. So the number of samples which we are using is low if you compare with international studies. It's only 40. But we wanted to cover a whole range of molecular description of the tumor. So not only the mutation, the methylation, and the transcriptome as usual, but also the proteome and the phosphoproteome, which is, the technology here is much lower throughput than the NGS technology used here. That's the reason why this number is low, and also because of course, and the supply of samples. So why this omics profiling at these different levels? Well, of course, to understand the biology, to find out the cell of origin also of medulloblastoma, which was still unknown before our project, and also to have models for the lab. That models meaning to have mouse cell lines or patient-derived xenografts to be able to do experiments in the lab, and then to identify a clinical portrait for diagnostic and prognostic and response prediction. And having biomarkers of these groups and developing clinical trials on proposing new therapeutic targets. So the first thing we did is to try to classify these 40 tumors, not based on the DNA methylation and sequencing like before, but now on the proteomics and phosphoproteomics data. You can see there on this drawing, how the bona fide groups which are represented on the top. At this line are respected or not when you do the classification with other types of information. What you can see is that, as I said before, group three and group four tends to be difficult to distinguish. But still, the proteomics also recapitulates more or less well the classification of medulloblastoma that can be derived from RNA and on methylation levels. Then we decided to cluster these data using the different types of information and to represent these clusters here. And what you can see here is that when you use DNA methylation, the classification comes as you see here, meaning that group one or two are quite, separated from three and four, which are a bit overlapping. And that's the same for transcriptome. It's just, what I said before. The interesting point is that when you look at the proteomic level and at the phosphoproteomic level, the picture is different. And at the proteomic level, the group four is really different from the other groups. So these give a hope to be able to distinguish much better patient from group four and patient from group three, and with the clinical implication I mentioned before. For the proteomic picture is a bit more fuzzy, but still the groups, in particular group four, is a bit separated from the others, though less than with proteomics. So what we did afterwards is to combine all of these types of data together, of course, to figure out how the classification will give a good separation or not. And indeed, that's the case. When you do so, you can indeed have a good separation of these different groups. And it means that then you are well armed for clinical treatment. So, but why did we do this phosphoproteomic analysis? I guess you all know this paradigm of genetics with a genome being transcribed into transcriptome and translated into proteome and regulated by the epigenome, and most of the cellular and molecular function being achieved at the proteomic level. But if you look at the correlation between the transcriptome and the proteome, what we see on this study, where you represent this correlation between protein on mRNA, is that the coefficient correlation is only 0.4. And in our data, we also did the same studies on the coefficient of correlation gene per gene between RNA and protein is also in general around the 0.5 for hypoprotein. This means that when you look at the transcriptome alone, as was done most of the time before, you only have half the picture, and you miss half of the picture at of the proteome level, and therefore you might overlook many perturbed cellular and molecular functions. This is of course due to the metabolism of transcriptome and proteome, and we'll check that a bit later. And also, the phosphoproteome is also very important because a lot of functions, like for example regulation of the cycle, are exerted at the level of the phosphoproteome. So when you have only 40 samples, it's difficult to do a powerful differential analysis because statistically you don't have a lot of power, so you need to have tricks to. And one thing we first did is to compare the ratio of protein to RNA across the different for each different subgroup. And what you can see here is that Wnt and SHH are quite centered, which is expected, but group three and group four are not. Excuse me. And the ratio protein RNA is much higher in group four than expected and much lower in group three. So these, mean that in terms of RNA and protein metabolism, there is something which differs between these two groups, so much help to might help to explain why they differ. And so what we did afterwards is to reason now at the pathway level, but you don't have enough data. That's also what thing you can do. You don't take gene per gene, but you reason pathway per pathway. And there you, on this slide, for each subgroup, we show the level of activation of different pathways using RNA level or using protein level on the left and on the right, okay? So what you can see is that the agreement between RNA and protein is quite average. Very often there is no agreement at all. And you retrieve, here, the Wnt pathway, which is activated in the Wnt subgroup, with SHH in the SHH group, MYC in the G3 subgroup, which was expected. But what was not expected or not known is that the RTK signaling is very, very activated into group four with respect to the other groups, which is not shown at all at the level of RNA. And last but not least, RNA metabolism is also very different from group three to group four. And we retrieve it, the information that we gained from the slide before where we compare the log ratio of protein to RNA levels. So looking now at the phosphoproteome level in group four, you can see that the picture is very, very fuzzy, but still you can retrieve, if you do pathway enrichment analysis, you can retrieve that the RTK signaling is overexpressed in group four. So what we did afterwards is to focus on RTK signaling, and in particular on PI3 kinase, mTOR, and MAPK pathways, and to look at the global level of phosphorylation of different samples independent from our study. And again, we retrieve this highly active RTK activity for group four. And then focusing on those genes or proteins which were overexpressed in these pathways, we selected ERBB4 and SARC, the most overexpressed, and could, using immunoblotting, check that they are indeed specific, overexpressed, and specific to group four. Then we did, we mapped the expression of SARC on the ABB4 on the developing cerebellum in order to identify the zone of expression, and it's in the nuclear transition zone, meaning that it's very likely to be the zone of origin of the disease. The next thing that our collaborator did is to construct a modified mouse by electroporating an activity detection of SARC into the developing embryo, and in a triple in a p53 double mutant, these type of mice developed very rapidly tumors, whereas when you don't have this double mutation, they don't develop tumor. So this clearly shows that SARC-A is the driver of this group, of the tumor development. And also this gives us a mouse model of medulloblastoma stoma. And this adequation of this mouse model to the GRIPS-CRAN group 4 was also confirmed by doing the transcriptome analysis of these different SARC engineered mice and comparing it to the transcriptome of the different patients subgroups. And there you can see that the SARC mutated mouse is close to the group 4 patients. So to conclude on this part, we have been able to delineate a bit better the biology of medulloblastoma, in particular the differences between group 4 and group 3, and to find out RTK as a specific activated pathway, set of pathways in group 4, and two biomarkers of this group 4. And we also have developed a mouse of model of medulloblastoma. And we now have opportunities for biomarkers and for clinical trials because we have inhibitors of ERBB4 or ERBB family, lapatinib, nizatinib are inhibitors of this family. So now they can be tried as therapeutic options for this disease. Okay, so that's the people involved. Now I would like to shift to another completely different project, and that's a methodology that we developed for analyzing and exploiting single cell data, for example, RNA-seq data. I think I'll be fast because I'm running a bit out of time. And I guess you already have a few talks about single cell RNA-seq sequencing, so you know how it works. The basic idea is that you can do the transcriptome at the single cell level, so you have access to the distribution of the transcriptome across many cells, and which gives you the opportunity to identify rare cell types and the heterogeneity of samples. And to study differentiation, for example, or progression in particular in cancer. The fact is that when you use this type of data, you are in very multidimensional space. Instead of having a few tens or a few hundreds or even a few thousands tumors, you have millions of cells. So you really need to have good exploratory methods and very efficient computational algorithms. And the other point is that if you are interested in finding trajectories, you are no longer in a linear world. You are looking for behaviors which are with bifurcations, with self-free decision here, meaning that the mathematics of linear modeling might not be applicable anymore. And also, it's very noisy on sparse data, and I will go fast, but I guess you all know that single cell data are much more noisy and sparse than bulk sequencing data. So it means that we need robust algorithm. When you do single cell sequencing, there are two types of application that you can do. One is to find different cell types. This means doing, in practice, clustering. And one is to find trajectories, for example, here. You have an example of trajectories with two possible branches. I will talk only about these trajectories. Yeah. So there are many tools which enable you to find trajectories. And in a recent survey, there were 60 of them, and we are part of them. And, but I would like to stress the fact that these tools, most of them, use k nearest neighbors graph, meaning joining together all points with their k nearest neighbors, which is okay when you do that, as is shown on this slide, with no noise, even for 10 neighbors. The graph that you have here is quite recapitulating your data, but as soon as your data is noisy, which is the case in single cell data, your graph becomes ugly. And you need to do a dimension reduction before doing this KNN computation, meaning that you lose a lot of the information within your data. You typically method the project into two or three dimensions, and you might lose a lot. So our tools is based on a manifold learning technique, those are elastic principal graphs. And you see a bit how it works here. I will just give you a glimpse of how it works. Imagine you have to recapitulate this type of data. One thing you can do is that, but it's not very satisfactory. I mean, the curve is very curvy, and probably you prefer this type of curves. And to position, nodes along this curve, so that you have something a bit smoother. And if you want to do that, it means that you need to position points close to your data points, not too far from each other, and with no curvy situation. This means that you can do that by minimizing this type of energy. The nice things about it, which minimizes the distances between the points, for example, the node and the data points. The nice things about it is that it's a quadratic form, so it can be easily optimized. It's very, it can be done very efficiently in terms of computational time, and it converges, so it's much, much faster than any other approaches. Of course, when you do that, you don't have the topology of your graph. And to get the topology, well, what we do is to navigate in the space of all possible topologies, starting by the simplest one, and then adding nodes and computing for each possible topology close to the current topology, if it improves or not the adequation to the data in the sense of the function, energy function I just mentioned before. So the nice thing is very fast, it's very robust to noise. On this slide I show, for example, if you have 90% noise in your data, you can still retrieve your tree. Okay, so LB fast now. I just mentioned that LP graph per se is a program, but it is integrated into a tool, a pipeline, a web-based interface with whom you can plot your gene activity, find out which genes are transition genes and branches, and diverging genes between perfect bifurcations, and so on. And you can try it at our collaborator website. So maybe very, very fast now, I will talk in 2 minutes about the last project I wanted to mention. It's about computing, in the case of disease, trajectories of patients during their medical journey. It's based on myocardial infarction, but it will be any disease, in fact. We took this one because we could get some public data from myocardial infarction, 1,700 patients. And for this patient, we had the 110 features describing their phenotypes and 12 features describing possible complications. So each patient was, annotated when it came to the hospital. It means that we have static picture for each patient. But the idea behind the study is that if you take the whole set of patients, they recapitulate all the trajectory of patients across their medical journey, from the mild case up to the little cases. And by accepting this hypothesis, you can compute using LP graph, as I mentioned before, a trees with all these 1,700 patients, and then analyze the trajectories of patients along the possible trajectories of patients along these trees. Correlate the variables, one of the 110 variables which characterize patients with the pseudotypes along these trees, and figure out which ones are associated to particular either complication or cause of death. For example, here you can see on this tree that patients with low age, in young patients in blue, tend to have to end up in these leaves, which are those with no complication, whereas old ones tend to move to a higher severity status. I don't have time, I think, to go much further. It's already more than 30 minutes. So maybe I just want to indicate that on these trees, you have many possible trajectories for a patient. For example, if a patient will take the trajectory from 8 to 55, we can plot the variables according to along these trajectories and position your patient on this trajectory and compute also the risk of evolution of this patient along this trajectory towards the final state of the trajectory using a regression based on the pseudo times computed by the principal graph algorithm. Okay, that's it. So the tool is available here, and I will stop my talk here and take questions. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Dr. Barrio, for this nice presentation. So we have a few questions. So I will give Celia B, if you are if yes. You have a question.
Yes, can you
ask.
Yeah, I wondered how you showed some similarity networks, ones that are built from individual transcriptomic or proteomic data, and ones with integrated data. So I wondered how were you, what were representing the edges in these networks?
Yeah, indeed. I mean, in this network, each node represents one sample, one patient, and the edges represent simply the similarity between the pairwise similarity between patients. So of course, with threshold, if they are not similar enough, we don't link them together. And then the thickness of the edge represents the strength of the similarity between the two nodes.
Okay, thank you.
So we had another questions. So from Benoit, is it better to use the UMAP or TSNE for pseudo time in single cells?
Well, I think both are fashionable tools, and most people that I know tend to try to use both of them. I could not recommend, a general recommendation on that. Disney has been very popular. UMAP is also very popular. And both, I think, are good tools. And but you're talking about pseudo time. So pseudo time is for trajectories, you know?
Okay, I don't know. So thank you. So thank you for your answer. We have another question. That's what is the challenges of digital twins or mixed reality in oncology?
That's quite a general question. It's something I mentioned at the end of my presentation, but I've not time to develop. I think one of the key problems that we have today in making this happen is that a lot of research is still needed to make use of these huge masses of data. And we really need to have an access to this data. You have seen this example I've shown for the application of the trajectory reconstruction. We use the myocardial infarction data from the 90s. So why did we do that? Because it's a very difficult data set which is available publicly to develop this type of software. There are good reasons for that. One of the good reasons is that we should, of course, guarantee the privacy of anyone's medical records. On the other hand, we also need to have to give access to medical data if we want research to be done on it, and better treatment to be better patient care to be developed. And the paradox is that most patients, they agree and they're ready to share the data, but the law today is quite also restrictive, complex. And I think we'll have solution to this situation soon, but as of today, it's very difficult to have very large data sets of real medical data to develop the appropriate software and methodologies to make this digital twin a reality. I would say that the main challenge today is to have access in a secure and confidential way to the data. That's the role of this health data hub that has been created recently by the French government.
Thank you for your answer. So I will give the right to talk to Anaïs Boudou, which have a question for you.
So hello, many thanks. It was really, really interesting. I was wondering on the first part on medulloblastoma, you said that it was very difficult from the data to distinguish in between group four, three and group four, but then you had bona fide ground truth labeling of your samples. And so how they were determined first?
There has been an evolution in the practices of the medical doctors for that. First, it was mainly based on anatomopathological examination and a few other clinical variables. But for the last 10 years, it has been based on RNA and methyl DNA methylation profiles. And but indeed, there is a paradox in when you do this research, you need to have some ground truth. And as you said, I mean, there is a gray area between group three and group four. I mean, some samples have been put in group three, but if you look at their RNA and DNA methylation profile, they're also very close to group four. At some point, you need to decide. And but what is nice is that by adding some other types of data, the separation between for these samples got separated from the others. So meaning that probably at some point we'll have to revise the methodology which is used today, the RNA plus DNA methylation, to classify these patients to be more confident on the correct classification.
And I have a follow-up question on that. Is that so? Did you check which data type was better at refining or defining the categories, or is it really the integration of the different layers that is really reaching the best classification?
We have not done a systematic check. I mean, it's not something which is, I mean, completely obvious, by the way, because the question is, what does it mean better? Of course, there are, I mean, statistical measurement of the separation between groups, but we also need to have results which are meaningful in terms of clinical practice and of biology, but also of clinical practice. So it's per se, it's a complex question. But what was the end of the question?
Yeah, it was meaning I was wondering if it was like phosphoproteomics plus DNA methylation, or maybe proteomics plus RNA that was leading to this four group separation better. And if, for instance, adding one additional layer would split the group three in two different subgroups. So yeah. It was more like if you have to do only one omics because you don't have a lot of money, which one would you do?
Well, as of today, I mean, the official rule, I mean, approved by the World Health Organization for grouping this patient already uses two omics resources. Mm-hmm. This means that clearly we cannot do with less than two. And to distinguish with group four from group three, we really need a third one. And the answer, which is, I mean, what today by a medical doctor is that we do RNA plus DNA methylation. It's not yet approved to do more. But we are rather going to want more omics profiling than less.
Okay.
I think. Unless we can find some very good marker. And for example, ERBB4 seems to be very specific from group four. So it might be, seems to be confirmed, but it might be enough to delineate group four. But it's completely useless to delineate groups one from two and from three. Mm.
Okay, thank you.
So we had another question, and maybe last one. We as you said in the previous answer, how do you deal with all the sensitive data of the patient in your domain that you need to secure and stock somewhere, as it's a so sensitive domain as oncology? Do you?
I guess the question refers to the problem of data privacy, data anonymization. So Well, there is a set of procedures for that. First, of course, I mean, the only data that we have are those which are needed for the research. Any other data, any other clinical data, we don't have access to it. Of course, they are anonymized, so we have no way to return to the patient. Only the medical doctor in charge could do that. That's why, I mean, in the list of collaborators, you see a medical doctor also for that, not only for that, but also for that. And there are, I mean, several ethical committees which have to approve the studies. I mean, in particular, our Curie ethical committees and also question of ethical committees, Necker, excuse me, obviously committees have to approve the study before it being done. So, and then in terms of computer, I mean, protection, of course, we are within an institute, which is also a hospital. So we, our computer department is taking care of making sure that privacy is respected. And the applicative part on top of it are also dealt with by our bioinformatics core facility, which is also, I mean, interacting a lot with the informatics department to implement software interfaces and so on in a way which makes them secure, you know, and guarantee no unauthorized access. Per se, it's a strong, okay. It's a strong constraint, but we have to do that.
Yeah, okay. We have a last one question from Carla Hereda. Is it okay to, yeah, you can talk, Carla.
Yes, do you hear me?
Yeah,
I can hear you.
So thank you for your relevant and interesting presentation. So I was wondering, because I'm pretty curious, have you explored the medulloblastoma subgroups in a point of view of epigenetics and three-dimensional genome organization? So I mean, have you tried to differentiate these four subgroups with maybe a chip sequencing study to explore the epigenetic profiles, or even with a HiSeq study to explore the genome organization of each group?
No, not yet. There are, I mean, project ongoing on that. But yeah. I should also mention that the main interest of the study was to add up proteomics and phosphoproteomics on top of the traditional NGS-based technologies. And there have been some other, I mean, publications on medulloblastoma done by the International Consortium for Cancer Genomics, ICGC, with a much more detailed, with a few hundreds of patients, I think it was 700 by memory, and a much more detailed subclassification of groups, but based on mutations, expression, methylation, and so on. So NGS-based technologies. And okay. The first author of this publication is Florence Cavalli, who happens to be now a young PI in the department, in our department. She did that when she was in Toronto, and mm-hmm. and she's now continuing this research. So she's interested by the same question that you evoked now, I mean, and yeah. Part of her new research. So, but she will be able to talk about that. I'm not.
Okay. Thank you.